be overcome, and we simply did households with children in them, whether there's one, two, or three children. In a sense, it doesn't really matter, because it's we want to know how many households with children, in which there are children, there are instances of domestic abuse. So it was really trying to be good. Could the way they indicated the information was collected be amended, and then we wouldn't have this sort of nuanced argument about how many children there are in a particular house?
Chair, I think there's a really good point about having greater clarity and improvement in the reporting. My understanding is this is in here to take account of, hopefully, increased reporting where there are children in households where there is domestic abuse. Not that it's a good thing that more children are referred per se, it's that there's better reporting so we can get to providing services for those children. But there may be a more refined way of doing that in future years.
Yes, Angie. I just wanted to say that in terms of the layout and the trends and the direction of travel, and the red, amber, green and the blue, the kind of exceeds and target, I think that's really, really good. I just wanted to point out, it ties into some of the stuff that Councillor Gilchrist was saying earlier about. I just look back at our July overview and scrutiny committee minutes, and I remember Claire going over kind of the data for the year, and she concentrated on what some of the challenges were from that data, and I think some of the challenges have come across into this monitoring, this performance monitoring, but there were some issues that haven't. So there was things around delayed transfer of care per 100,000 to population that hasn't come over. There was also around the percentage of people getting discharged opiate and non-opiate, drug-free from substance misuse services. So I'd like some of that information to still be monitored.
I'm going to sum up, if you don't mind. And first of all, we'll say, look for comments on what people think about this as an improvement or not. And add a few things in. I think we would like to see whether or not course two to be reported in January, whether that would be more meaningful. But we added indicators around apprenticeships. I'd like to see the sponsors identified, because one of the things that we've been concerned about, really, is how we scrutinise people who are not counselors.
Soon. the initial costs are being offset by primarily by two technical accounting budget reductions. The first is in treasury management and reduced cost of borrowing, and the second is reducing the cost of accounting for capital assets. Overall, taking those adjustments into account, the report talks about an overall underspend of the council this time of more than £2 million. The book goes on to talk, give some commentary on the achievements of council savings, the £41 million savings that the effective for the current year, two-thirds of which are green and blue. £9 million of those savings are raised at red, most of which have been canvassed in well-being, and this looks the overspend that we're talking about. The report also talks about collection income, which is comparable with previous targets. And finally, in the end, as you can see there, that the budget has been reallocated according to the new operating model. We also talk about capital in Appendix 2. This report talks about the progress implemented capital's £2 million programme, of which the revised programme for children is £9 million, which is £3 million. And the bit that draws attention to is paragraph 312. And this comments on additional facilities that are available to local authorities due to capital seeds in the future, which can be used to deliver transformation programmes that reduce costs and improve outcomes. Chair, I'll pause that.
I just only make a general comment about it. It's really on our adult social services and the way we do the budget. We always put a number in for demographic changes and inflation, and then we take it out, and then we wonder why we get caught out when it actually comes around. So I think when in looking at next year's budget, it's really around the savings to do with integration and the real savings that we think we're going to achieve, because if we're going to take out those demographic pressures, we've got to see some real reason as to how we're going to achieve it.
Thanks very much. Very insightful comments. The issue is that there are a number of savings in the current year budget. And some of those savings we've been able to make, and some of those savings we haven't been able to make into the full amount. And they, as you suggest, Alan, do offset some of the growth areas. Going forwards, as you say, what we've looked at is demographic growth, inflation, living wage, incremental increases, all of those things, and forecast what that would be for the council's budget. Offsetting those, then there's the social care precept, which roughly equates to the living wage incremental increase, and the better care funding with the NHS. The thing with the better care funding with the NHS is that we need to have integration plans with them and make sure that our resources are used together to get a better effect across our health and care system. So again, comments in terms of tied up with plans around the NHS as well as the social care. Absolutely true. Okay,
yes. If you've got more
to say,
keep going. Thank you. Thank you very much. Item 10 is the terms of reference for the children's subcommittee. There's an addition to the terms of reference, which is, it's related to the discussion that we had around the rural pledges. And there are 3 points to add. Actually, you've got a further one on the pledges to include in there, which
I just wanted to, in terms of reference for the Children's Subcommittee, it refers to three of the rural plan pledges. I just wanted to ask if reducing child and family poverty could be included